Milton Coronado. Let's give him a hand.
Good afternoon, y'all. Good afternoon. Hey.
Oh, thanks.
Milton, nice to meet you. Born and raised in Chicago, Mexican American, and that's me. I'd like to get your name and where you guys are from, starting right here. Because I remember standing one time, particularly in 2001, I'm 21 years old, standing in front of my father's naked body, in front of a glass window that separated us, where he's laid naked over this silver platter and wet, because behind him was this African-American man, very tall, very big individual with his mask over his face and a leather apron down the front part of his body, wearing black leather gloves and a hose. He steps back after getting the direction from the person to my right, telling him to move. And as I'm standing and looking at my father's naked body, here's this lady who was elevated 3 or 4 feet off the ground to my right. And she's asking me a series of questions like, what is your name? Where do you live? How old are you? And then she asks too, what is the name of the person that you see in front of you? And what is your relationship to that individual? And that's all. His name is Ramiro Coronado, and he is my father. She filled out the form that she had in front of her. She took a few seconds to share that. It was quiet between us. And she said, well, thank you very much, sir. You may leave. So I remember taking 3 steps back and taking this final look at my father as he lay there in a somewhat alive state. I turned around and I left with my brother-in-law, my brother, my girlfriend, and a pastor. They were standing outside. They were not permitted in this little 6 by 6 square footed room that I was in. And I was still there alone with this lady to my right, looking at my father. And as I left and I'm walking to my car, I'm in tears and I'm angry, angry at God, angry at my family, angry at friends, angry at the violence in the city, angry at the law, angry at the detectives, angry at the person who killed my father, just angry and crying and wondering, what is my life going to be like now? I wouldn't be here today if it wasn't because of my conviction, because of my beliefs, because of, honestly, I don't know how you feel, but it wasn't for God, really. Because it was Him that stands here before you today, and grounded in that understanding, I want to share the following. This is me. When I was, I don't know how I was honestly here, but less than one, just a few months old, my mother, it took a while last time too.
Oh, okay.
My mother, at the age of 18, 19 years old, she immigrated to this city from a big city in Mexico called Guadalajara, which is in the state of Jalisco, second biggest city in Mexico after Mexico City. So she immigrates here because her brother was already here, and he had arranged for her to come, and my aunt as well, and another sibling to the city. So they come here and they live together. My mom, she started working in a factory. In this factory, she met this individual who was part of a system of crimes that dealt with violence and drugs and narcotics and border crossings and illegal stuff. You get the idea. With him, she had 3 children, Caesar, Miguel, and Claudia. And in this situation, because money and power and respect was a priority for her husband, the relationship was broken and it was diminishing and it was just messed up. One time, my aunt tells me that he grabbed my mother and he pushed her through this glass door where she shattered her skull and she had to get stitches, had to get hospitalized. After years of abuse with this individual, she had it. She said, you know what, I can't deal with this anymore. So she filed for divorce, they got a divorce, and she went to go live in the first floor of a building that my aunt and uncle owned in the south side of Chicago, like in the 31st and Pulaski area. There, my aunt lived with my two brothers, and my sister. My aunt, she would always tell my mother, you know what, you're depressed, you're down, you're broken, you need to heal. You need to concentrate on your kids and care for them and for yourself. Don't think about dating, don't think about socializing, don't think about having fun or going out. Just take your time. Whatever you need, I got you back. A couple months later, my aunt, my grandmother moves in, and she had this whole different mentality than my aunt. their mother, who she did not raise, by the way. My grandmother, she had this very, you know, youthful, you could say, for lack of a better word, attitude about life. She didn't care about anything, just about herself, and just having a great time. She had several men in her life, she partied a lot, very flamboyant, her music was... And so she told my mother some night, she said, let's go out. After being influenced and pressured by her mother, my mother decided, fine, I'll go out. And at this dance club, the only Spanish music playing club in the city at the time, in the early 70s, she met this individual. Individual 7 years younger than her, also from the same city in Mexico as she, approaches her, very sharp looking individual. He approaches her, introduces himself with a fake name because, you see, at that time, cell phones and beepers, as well as social media and internet was not around. So how do you find out information about them? You don't. So because they could be fishy and scary individuals, you have to kind of like play cool by giving a fake name to the person. So he gave a fake name to my mother. She responded with a fake name as well. They danced, they hit it off, they probably kissed, I don't know. And they finally introduced themselves with their real names. Hello, my name is Ramiro Coronado. What? My name is Emma Diaz. Wow, nice to meet you. And they developed this secretive relationship, this boyfriend-girlfriend relationship that nobody knew, but only them. You know, this particular city of Chicago where they live, 31st and Pulaski, homes are very close to each other. Probably like some of the homes in this part of the city. So my father, because again, nobody knew that they were dating, and he wanted to see her at night, and she might couldn't come out because of her kids or whatever situation, living with her sister. He would creep in through the window by climbing up like Spider-Man between these two homes and creeping through the window and lay with her. Well, this is a true story, by the way. I cannot make this up, would not make this up. He creeps in through the window one night, lays on bed, caresses, plays around, fools around, only to find out that it was my grandmother on the bed and not my mother at that time. True story. Lights go on, people barge into the bedroom. I can just imagine my aunt and uncle coming from the second floor to the first floor, like, hey, what's going on? And my mother and my grandmother probably like smiling, like, hey, leave us alone. We're having a great time, hey, continue. My mom then declares, well, this is my boyfriend. What? Everybody's surprised, fine, whatever, okay. And I assume it was in one of the situations that they hung out, where then 9 months later I was born on July 4th, 1980. So then my father had to take responsibility. I grew up Christian, but at the time they were not Christians, they were not married, so they moved in together. My father moves into this first floor apartment at this building that my aunt and uncle owned. And here he is, this individual dating and living now with his girlfriend, who is pregnant with his child, who has 3 children prior to him. With her first marriage. And these boys were reckless. They were messed up because their father messed them up. I mean, my brothers in the third and fourth grade, they were already selling marijuana. And my oldest brother did not get along with my father at all. But my father stayed there. After I was born, 10 months after that, my sister Lynette is born. And like 3 years after her, my other sister Annette is born. So here we are now, 3 boys, 3 girls, children, living in this first floor apartment with my mother and my father. And everything I thought, you know, was going great in my eyes as a 4-year-old, 3-year-old boy. But later in life, I found out that my father was also very abusive towards my mother. He wasn't physically abusive like her first husband, throwing her against windows and doors and hurting her and punching her and kicking her. But my father was verbally and emotionally abusive towards her. He would look at a woman and then look at my mother and say, you're not as good looking as her. See that dress that she's wearing? She looks hot on her. It wouldn't look good on you. Why do you look like that? Wear that. Don't do that. Don't do this. Very controlling, very emotionally and verbally abusive towards my mother. My mother had it. She was tired of all the abuse. One time she came across this one paper where an individual was promoting Bible studies. So she filled it out and she took part of Bible studies, and that's how she became a Christian. After prayer and much conviction and faith for my father, my father then accepted this faith, married my mother in 1984, and then got baptized in a Christian community. Well, here we are in this happy family, right? My oldest brothers are not getting along with my dad. Everything's going great. We're going to church. We're well dressed, all nice, left his bartending job at the gay bar. He started a construction company. He was still painting cars, but he also had a part-time job working at, as a butcher. My mom's working at a factory. We're living with my aunt and uncle in this building. Everything was going great. But in 1985, we were hit with the tragedy that set off a very roller coaster of a life for me. This is me before I was 1 year old. It's my mother. We're celebrating my first birthday. My father, this is before I was born, Christmas at the time when he was dating my mother. This is my mother holding me and with my three older siblings. I believe we were attending my cousin's birthday party, who was just a few months older than I was. So here we are, this happy family, right? Assuming everything is going great, nothing bad can happen. But one morning, my mom goes to church before all three sisters went. Because my mom had to get there before most of the people from church so that she can start this morning worship program service. So we finally get to church, and I remember going down the stairs of the church and seeing a group of individuals huddled over someone who I couldn't identify that was on the floor. And I'm like this 5-year-old boy now, 1985, trying to see through the cracks, through the holes, between the legs and arms of people, trying to find out who was on the floor. Paramedics come and they put their bags down. People moved away, but even they covered my view towards the person that was on the floor. And my sister pulls me back and she said, "Don't go over there. You're too little. Let them do their job. You gotta go away. Go over there. Go over there." And I went away. I forgot where I went, but I left not knowing who the person on the floor was. It was my mother. She had fainted in the basement of our church. A couple days later, I remember leaving Mount Sinai Hospital. You see, I was too young to go inside in a room and talk to my mother, visit my mother. So I remember waiting in a nursing room with my two sisters. And as we're leaving the hospital towards our car, my father points to me, he taps me on my left shoulder, and he points me towards a window that my mother stood at wearing this blue Mount Sinai created gown. To this day, I could drive down Ogden, driving east on Ogden Avenue, and I can still identify the window that my mother stood at. But I remember looking at my mother and she crossed her arms. She pointed at herself, she crossed her arms over her chest, and she pointed at me and she said that she loved me. And I said, "Great, my mom loves me. I love you too, mommy. Bye." And I left home, not knowing that the next time I was going to see my mother was not going to be at home, over my bed, or over hers, or on the kitchen table, or over dinner. But I saw my mother the next time after that in a casket. My mother passed away when I was 5 years old. On October 28th, 1985, from a brain aneurysm. What that is, basically what happened, a vein in the back of her head burst. Blood came out of her eyes, her nose, her ears, and her mouth. And here I am now, a 5-year-old boy, standing right there in this tan or beige looking jacket, next to my sister who was 4 at the time. And she's standing in front of my aunt. My aunt's best friend, her sister. And we're both in front of my father who's bending down behind me. Pastors, friends, and family, cousins are behind us, surrounding the casket, saying their last goodbyes to my mother. So my 3 older siblings, they went to live with their father, who was very abusive, and left my father with a 5-year-old boy, 4-year-old girl, and 1-year-old girl, and he wondered, what am I going to do? So he thought, okay, I have to fix this situation. I have to provide them with a mother. So he thought, I'm going to go to Mexico, and I'm going to marry the woman that I cheated on my wife with. You see, before my father before my mom passed away, right after getting my mom pregnant for the last time, a month after getting her pregnant, he went to Mexico and he met a girl who's 13 years younger than him, and he got her pregnant. That's why today I have 2 siblings that are the same age, just a month apart. I grew up telling my little brother, the one that was born in Mexico, "You're not my brother, you're not my brother, you're not my brother. You look different, you smell different, you dress different, okay? And you're the same age as my sister, who I saw come home from the hospital. You're not my brother." And this is what I grew up telling this kid, to a certain point in my life where I just thought, okay, he is my half-brother. And so obviously that created a bad relationship between his mother, my stepmom, and me. I remember meeting her for the first time. I'm hiding behind the sofa, living at my aunt's house, while my father was in Mexico, bringing us a new mom. And I pop out, and I'm like, Papi, ah, surprise! And my father, before even hugging me or saying hi to me, he says, hey, what have you done? This is your new mommy. And I'm like, what? You're not my new mommy? I have a mom, and she's sleeping. You're not my new mommy. And I remember giving her the two fingers, because I learned that from my aunt, who I was living with. And I cursed her out, because I learned curse words from my aunt, who I was living with for 2 weeks. My father gets upset at his sister. He takes her to the kitchen. They start arguing. Here I am looking at this lady, and giving her the finger every so often. Looking at my little brother, who was dressed differently, big head, smelled differently, smelled like Mexico, whatever that smells like. And I'm like, you're not my brother. You're not my brother. You're not my brother. She looks at me very evil. I don't know what she was thinking, but today I placed myself in the shoes. I'm probably thinking like, jeez, this is my kid now? But these two girls over there were crying? Great. What did I get myself into? I grew up with this woman abusing me and my siblings, including her son, physically abusing us. We decided to move to San Antonio, Texas for a while, for 2 years of my life, my fourth and fifth grade. It didn't go so well for my father, so he said, you know what, I'm going back to Chicago. I want to save money. I'll bring you guys back, we'll get a house, and we'll just get situated. We'll stay in Chicago, no more leaving. Fine. But those 2 years of my life were the worst in my life because my father, my defense, my best friend, the one who truly loved me, okay, my real parent, he wasn't there to protect me. One time I got in a fight with my little brother, my half-brother, Caesar. We had bunk beds. He slept on the bottom, I slept on top. For some reason, we were playing on the top bunk, and I kicked him, blah, right in the face. And he started bleeding. And you know what siblings do when you fight? They're like, shh, quiet, quiet. I'll give you candy, I'll give you candy, I'll give you candy. Shh, quiet, don't tell mommy, don't tell papi, don't tell mommy, don't tell papi. So he's like trying to hold him in like this, holding this candy that I gave him, so that he will not cry louder. And he gave me in trouble. But then she comes right in front of our door, right in front of our bedroom. The door was open, so she walks right in front. All heavy, down, down. And guess what he did? And he started yelling, very exaggerated. I'm like, chill, relax, man, relax. It's just blood. It's just blood on your shirt and your face and the pillow. It'll go away. Stop exaggerating. She barges in. She's like, what happened? Right? Very violently. And he tells her, Milton kicked me. And the evidence was right there, all the blood all over the place. So she kicks me out, physically kicks me out. Boom, boom, outside the house. In my shorts. I'm not wearing socks, I'm not wearing shoes, I'm not wearing a t-shirt. It's Texas, it's hot, but outside, it's cold at night. So here I am just trembling, like, please, somebody help me out. I'm just in my shorts. Thankfully, I just switched from briefs to boxers. I'm like, come on, come on, come on. I knock on my sister's window, and I'm like, hey, please, Lena, give me a blanket, I'm cold, I'm cold. And she's giving me a blanket. Her mom, stepmom, barges in, starts beating her up for helping me. I'm like, great. So then she calls me a couple minutes later. It felt like an hour or eternity out there. I don't know, it could have been 30 minutes, 20 minutes, I don't know. She calls me and she's standing in the door frame like this. She's like, get in! And I'm hesitant because I know that once I cross her path, once I go under her arms, guess what's gonna happen? Blah! And that's exactly what happened. I walk in, she's like, blah! And then she said to me this, what she repeatedly told us all the time. You better not tell your dad, because if you tell him, you're gonna get it worse. So whenever he would call, of course I wouldn't tell him. Milton, how's everything? How's everything? Great, bye. While she's standing there like this. Great, bye. It's great, Buffy. It's great. When are you coming? When are you coming? Bye. We're gonna hang up. I feared for myself and for my siblings. I thought if I told her the truth, if I told them the truth, yeah, she's kicking us, she's beating us, she's locking us in the bedroom, she's hurting us. As soon as I hung up that phone, I was gonna get it worse. Yeah, I knew he was gonna come and intervene and do something and another problem would arise between them two, but we were still gonna get a beating. So I lied to my father all the time. Everything's great, Dad. Everything's great, but things weren't. Finally, we come back to Chicago and we moved to Cicero, then to Berwyn. In 1987, my sister's born, my sister Jeanette, my half-sister. I graduate eighth grade, I start high school, and I joined this gang. Because I thought it was cool, I thought it was bad. That's what's up, right? That's what we do. I thought it was cool, it was bad. But the reality is, I was just rebelling, and I was fighting against a system at home that was just hurting me. My father was always working. There was times when I wouldn't see my father for days because he would go to work before I would get up, and he would come back after I went to bed. He would do this for 3 or 4 days or nights in a row. So because I didn't want to be home and dealing with this crazy woman that was raising us, okay, I was like, you know what, I'd rather be outside. If I'm going to get beat up, if I'm going to get punched, if I'm going to get kicked, I'd rather do it outside while I gain respect and friends and girls than at home by this woman who's supposed to love me. So I joined this gang for 2 years. I thought it was cool. My freshman year, I remember I was hanging out with my two friends and we were going to watch a fight or be part of the fight. I don't remember. But as we're walking, these two cars popped up at us. And these guys, older than us, they're driving. I'm just a freshman in high school. They chase us. And we went through this, you know, gangway between two homes. And we stopped in an alley. And we separated ourselves a few feet away from each other. We're like, which way should we go? That way, that way, that way. Which way? I don't know. Not that way because over there. What should we do? One of them comes. He passes me up, passes up my friend, goes directly to my other one, starts beating him up. Then another guy comes, the second guy, starts beating up my friend over here in front of me. And as I'm getting ready to help one of them, the third guy comes, and I'm like, okay, here we go. And I'm ready to fight, throw down with him, but then he pulls out a gun, puts it in my forehead, and asks me if I want to die. And I said, God, please help me, save me from this, take me out of this. Please rescue me. I promise I will never hang out with these guys again. I will never do this. I will never do that. Please. And just when I said that, I remember feeling the guy hitting me over the head with the gun. And then the fourth guy comes. He's like, hey, that's not them. That's not them. That's not them. And without excusing themselves, they left. And we walked home, dropping each other off at each other's homes. And I was the last guy to go home. I get home, and my sister's like, what happened? Like, guess what happened? I told her, she said, you're stupid. You're stupid. You're stupid. With that accent, too, with that. And okay, relax. I'm here now. She feels my forehead, my top of my head. She's like, yeah, you have a huge bump, but you're bleeding. And that's when I started feeling the pain. I started feeling nauseous, you know, dizzy. I had to rest. But I continued my life for 2 years like that until my junior year in high school. When I got involved with graffiti heavily, a lot more than anything else I've done in my life. This took over my life. I was eating it, I was breathing it, I was living it. This was, graffiti was my life. I was addicted to it. Getting up at 1 o'clock, 2 o'clock, 12 o'clock in the morning by myself, my brother, with my friends to go paint the trains, the garages, the homes, the abandoned factories, the city, my community, because I was addicted to this. See, all my life, I really enjoyed art. As soon as my mom passed away, I started communicating my pain, my anger through drawing. When I was in second grade, I was suspended for drawing sexual and violent things. The teacher told my father he needs therapy, he needs help, he needs some kind of medicine, something, because this is not normal for a second grader to draw. And so my father's medicine was the belt, right across my butt, several times, in the basement of our house. One particular time after these drawings, my father said, I forbid you to draw. So for a couple years, I stopped drawing. By the time I was in high school, I started drawing it again. By the time I was in junior high school, I was introduced to the art of the airbrush. So I started airbrushing t-shirts for my friends and hustling, making money that way at school, picking up orders at school and painting them at home, dropping off the next day, picking up more money and orders, and just doing that for the last 2 years of my high school days. Then I got introduced to graffiti in the middle of my junior year, after I was already airbrushing, because my friends, they're like, dude, man, your stuff is good. Have you done it on a wall? I'm like, no, but I'd like to one day. Dude, we're gonna go painting, come with us. I'm like, cool. So I remember getting all dressed in black and going with my friends and painting around town. And I got addicted to it. It was my drug. The top left picture, three acronyms, UNV. I did that in front of the cops. And I was so proud of myself because I was chased by them and I didn't get caught. I thought it was cool. I thought it was bad. The next picture to the right. My friends and I, we broke into an abandoned building. We took a radio, we took our lunches, we took a lot of old scrap paint, like old paint, spray paint, and we just spent the whole bottom left picture says Weiler. That's actually painted on the factory next to the orange line that you guys will be passing by. However, the painting is no longer there, of course. I actually did that on a Saturday afternoon, right before I went on a date with the girlfriend that I had on time. I called her up, she said, well, I didn't call her because we didn't have cell phones back then. But I knocked on her door, she's like, give me 15 minutes. I'm like, all right, cool. That actually meant like 30 or 40 minutes. So so I got in my car and I'm like, I got paint back. I want to go paint. So I did this while I waited for her to get ready so that we can go out on a date. The picture next to that one, the bottom right. I'm now going out with a different girl about a year and a half later. And because I was so addicted to this, I decided to go to that instead of going on this date that I had planned with my girlfriend. You see, my girlfriend had this banquet at school, and because I'm her boyfriend, I was supposed to go with her, right? It's logical. So she said, don't be here about 8, we're gonna get ready, we'll go, blah, 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 great. So here I am getting ready at home, she's getting ready at her house, and then my friend, the one in the picture, he calls me up, or he sends me a page or beep to my beeper, I call him back, and he's like, bro, what are you doing? I'm like, oh, no, I'm just getting ready for this thing. All right. What about you? He's like, oh, I want to go painting. I'm like, yeah, that'll be fun. But I'm like, how about afterwards? You going to be in the city? How about after? He's like, fine, okay. Calls me up again. He's like, let's just go right now. Fine. So because I wouldn't say pressure because I could have said no, but I accepted to go. I decided to go painting with him and my brother and another friend. Four of us painting the trains in Chicago while my girlfriend pays back and forth in her living room at her house for 3 hours waiting for me to get there. There's no cell phone, so she couldn't call me. She's paging me, but I'm ignoring it because the beeper's in my car while I'm pacing. She's pacing back and forth in her living room. Her siblings and her parents are like going like this. Every car that passed by, she thought it was me. She hoped it was me. She's looking out the window. Her family's like, is that him? No, that was not him. Every car that passed by just broke her heart even more. For 3 to 4 hours. She went to bed that night in her dress. The next morning, she sent me another page to my beeper, and I'm like, oh man, okay, I think of a good lie. Okay, got it, cool. I call her back, and she's all yelling, what happened, blah, 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 blah. I'm like, listen, baby, boo. listen. This is what happened. You know how my dad is so strict, and I can't say no to him, and he needed my help. We need to go take something from one house, put it in the truck, take it to another house and install it over there. It was like a washer or a dryer. I don't know what I said, but it was all a lot. And she's like, I'm sorry. I'm like, it's okay, baby, I forgive you. Yeah, for real. And then I told him, but today, whatever you want today is your day. I'm gonna spoil you today, so whatever you want, name it. Oh, you're so sweet, thank you. You're sweeter, thank you, yes. All right, love you. And so we hang up, and I'm like, whoo, whoo, got away with that one, cool. But this fool called her up. Guess what he said? He tricked on me because he was so excited. He told her. So she called me up and she's like really, really upset at me. I had to apologize several times. But it was such a great time. I love this guy. This is my boy. We're friends. We're connected through social media. We talk to each other once in a while. He's really like one of my brothers. But it was such a crazy time that night. I was so mad at him telling him, but you know, the excitement one couldn't hold back, I guess. But that was my life, that was my drug. I graduated high school in 1998. I went to Morehead West, which is a Berman right across the street from North Riverside Park Mall. And I started my college career. But in 1999, the first year in college, I found out that my parents were gonna get a divorce. So unlike many, I was really happy. Finally, no more crazy woman at home. Finally, peace and quiet, okay. But I saw my father and I knew he loved him. And I saw how devastated and how broken he was out of respect for him because I loved him and I had a good relationship with him. I was like, okay, no more graffiti. I gotta stop. But then I saw him dating again. Yeah, he was dating again. I'm like, okay then, all right. Time to get back in the game. So I started doing graffiti once again. But I also got much more involved in church. I got involved in youth ministry. I was helping my dad out a lot more in construction. Every Sunday I was working with him. Monday to Friday I was in school. Life was okay. My dad was happy and that's all that mattered. to me. I'm happy and I'm good. Cool. But just when we think that things are going great in our lives, we sometimes have to take a step back and kind of try to see our life from an outsider's perspective, because that's when question marks start popping up, like, why does my life seem so perfect right now? Something's probably gonna happen, something's going on, and something happened in my life. And I say this out of experience. That's my father, picture taken in one of his job sites. That's the type of work that he did. And that's the type of work that he taught me, that's the type of work that I hated, but I learned how to do. And it was on a Sunday morning when he was on his way to go to a job similar to this, where he was shot and killed by the same gang I was part of. Yeah. On September 30th, 2001. And here's my family, my siblings, pastors, and friends, and members of our church, saying our respectful goodbyes to my dad for the last time. And it was on this day, on the October 4th, 2001, that I decided to just change my life completely. I teared like I never teared before, and I decided to stop doing graffiti, because according to my understanding, graffiti was just bad, it was a crime, it was vandalism, and I'm gonna get arrested, I'm gonna have a bad record, and I don't want that. I deserve my father, my mother, who are no longer here. I want a better life for myself and for my future. So I stopped doing graffiti. But 4 or 5 years later, I come to find out that, you know what? This is a gift from God to me. And it's not about what I, it's not about what I do with my gift, but how I decide to return it back to Him, to the one who gave it to me. Because He gives us gifts, and what we do with them is our gift to Him, and decided to do something great with it. So out of counsel and advice and reading and prayer and a lot of serious time, you know, just connecting with the one and only, and connecting with others and understanding the need and the communities and wanting to be better and wanting to help others, I decided to go back into graffiti. But this time, rather than just vandalizing and damaging property that didn't belong to me, I decided to give it back to Him and to serve others with it. My father, when he died, my stepmom was 7 months pregnant, and this is my sister today, who has never met my father. And I believe one day she will. I started doing graffiti once again, and this is the first piece that I did after 4 or 5 years without ever touching a spray can. Just in a way of thanking Him for the 4 years of my life that followed my father's passing. Like I said, I give my talents back to God, and I've just been blessed with how I'm able to use them now. I was able to paint this mural, and this mural was a cover of one of the books that I wrote that were published. I also painted this mural on the south side of Chicago, very close to the orange line, by the way. It's still standing today. This was about about 3 years old. I painted this Jesus character as well between my two friends who painted graffiti letters to my left, to my right. And it was a pretty cool conversation that we had after that, because they look at it and go, yo, is that Jesus Christ? I'm like, yeah, man. Ah, instead of laughing, you said Jesus is a tiger. I'm like, yes, bro. He's like, what? And to him, come in and show a little love through some Bible study. It was pretty cool. A piece that I did last Easter. Can you guys read that? What does it say? Five letters.
Jesus.
I also do portrait as well, not just graffiti, but I also do brushwork and brushwork. Like Audrey Hepburn that I did. And I'd like to show you some more. So here's one. This is mixed media. This is spray paint, airbrush, and acrylic paint marker. This is a picture of a tiger. I don't really do animals, but my friend commissioned me to do this because he was going to give it to his fiance who loved tigers, right? But then they break up, and now he's married to a different woman. So now I'm stuck with it. right? I'm gonna see him next week. He lives in California. I'm going to California next week. Actually, I'll be Friday. I should take him. Be like, here you go, bro. Surprise! Happy wedding gift. Make me so mad. Watching your wife be like, I love it. Babe, did you tell him to do it for me? He did, girl. He did. And just for you. And that's a portrait of Jesus with a filtered mask over his face. With that being said, I just want to end with this statement, quote, if you will. You know, we all want to be skillful sailors, one way or another, skillful in something. We all want to be great individuals. We all want to serve in respectable areas that we're studying. We all want to have great careers, etc. But I just want to challenge you guys and understand this, okay? That in order to be great, everyone wants to, we have to go through tempest weather. We have to go through that those hard times because it builds character, gives us wisdom, gray hair. Maybe no hair later, but it makes us better people. And I had to go through these tempest weather to become a skillful sailor in my area of life. As a Christian, as a father, as a husband, as an artist, as a teacher, as a pastor, I had to go through this because there was greater plans for me as there are for you guys.